Welcome to another edition of Critical Insight on Your World News. I'm your host, Solomon Kamajan.
And I'm your co-host, Tim Bonoff-Lenshin.
And today, it's an absolute pleasure to be joined by Eric Draitser of StopImperialism.com. It's quickly becoming one of our favorite websites that we visit, and I just discovered this website by way of an interview that Eric did with James Corbett, and it's an unbelievable fountain of information and resources. And so, just want to welcome you, Eric, onto Critical Insight of Your World News. It's an honor.
Hey, thanks so much for having me. It's an honor on my end.
The first question I'd like to ask you, can you tell our viewers about StopImperialism.com, your website, and the podcast?
Sure. StopImperialism.com is kind of, it's sort of just my project. It includes podcasts, my articles, my appearances on various media. So it's kind of the go-to place for all of my political work. This is something that developed, I don't want to say it developed directly out of Occupy Wall Street, because that would be not true. But my experiences in Occupy Wall Street and then my frustration as I left Occupy Wall Street kind of morphed into this project where I wanted to really engage with these political issues, the geopolitical issues, which is always kind of my main focus, my main interest, and do so in a way on my own terms. The problem that I had at the very beginning with my experience with Occupy was that I simply wasn't able to achieve what I wanted to achieve, that is to move in a certain direction, start to building a movement or being part of a movement. Now, this is not to criticize Occupy Wall Street. It's merely to say that Stop Imperialism emerged out of the frustration that I felt in not being able to go in the direction that I wanted to. So it's kind of that's kind of the main impetus for it, is how do I put my information, my ideas, my political views and analysis out into the, you know, into the blogosphere, and do so in a way that could be productive. And, you know, it's always incredibly gratifying to hear people say what you just said, that my website, my podcast is a resource, and that's really what I want it to be.
Definitely. Thank you so much. Want to just really hit the ground running and ask you if you can reflect on what does Obama, President Obama, Barack Obama's reelection mean to U.S. foreign policy, imperialism, which you cover very broadly, drone attacks, and the like. What does that mean for the rest of the world and imperialism in general?
Well, it depends on who you ask, but there are many people around the world who will say that another term for Obama means more deaths in their families, means more drone bombings, it means more of the same, more meddling and interventions and imperialist aggressions, as we saw in Libya, as we're seeing in Syria. So, I mean, I think this is the obvious point, but I also point to maybe a less obvious aspect of all of this, and that is Romney and what Romney represented in the circle that surrounded him. So these neocons, right-wing, you know, reactionary imperialists, but the problem that people had was in thinking that Obama was not equally surrounded by similar types who may share many of these same imperialist goals. And so what we're seeing is essentially the creation, or maybe the continuation, of an oligarchy. And Obama is merely just the most recent face of this oligarchy. So what does a second term for Obama really mean? Well, I think that on the one side, we're probably not as close to a war with Iran as we might have been with a Romney administration. On the other side, we're probably much closer to multiple secret wars in Africa, to the expansion of AFRICOM, to the continuation of meddling in the Middle East, to, I mean, you know, you name it, destabilizations of Venezuela, of Argentina, of Ecuador, you know, all over the world. What we see is that the Obama administration, like the Bush administration or the Clinton administration before it, really have no restraint when it comes to flexing the muscle of the U.S. empire, and that's what we'll see for the next 4 years.
Thank you, Eric. I know you recently did a podcast about what's going on in Pakistan right now, and I'd like to ask you why Obama's re-election has infuriated the people in Pakistan at this moment.
Well, there's two different camps, I think, that we really need to think about. On the one hand, those are the people who are directly impacted by Obama's policies. These would be the people who lose their family members in these drone attacks, the wedding parties that are constantly bombed and obliterated. So that is one aspect of this. The second side of this would be the Pakistanis who are not necessarily directly impacted by the drone bombings, but who view Obama, the administration, and the United States in general as essentially being being an enemy state, one that plots the destruction of Pakistan. I think that this is a very real thrust within the U.S. ruling class. They would like to see Pakistan carved up into something similar to Sudan or any of the other countries that the imperialist powers have carved in throughout history. And so what does Pakistan see in Obama? They see a continuation and an expansion of U.S. imperialism. They also see, and this is an important point, a move away from the norms of international relations, a move away from international law. Pakistan thought at one point that they had sovereignty. They thought that they had national rights. And even, and this is incredible that I'm saying this, but even more than the Bush administration, the Obama administration is viciously attacking Pakistan. And so, you know, I mean, I recently covered an article from the Times of India where they were quoting, you know, a 28-year-old young man, same age as me, 28-year-old who lost his entire family in a drone bombing, who watched the re-election of Obama and immediately got pains in his head because of that, because it brought back all of the pain and all of the suffering. So, you know, to humanize the situation is to criticize and to attack Obama, and that is very important. Obama cannot be allowed to continue in this way.
Right. And you know, since you just you brought up Bush, if for any Obamanistas that are watching right now, can you draw a comparison and contrast between Obama's use of drones and Bush? Because I remember distinctively in 2005, 2006, 2007, being out there and having, you know, folks who are now Obamanistas out protesting Bush and the war in Afghanistan, obviously Iraq. They were talking about, you know, about the use of drones, but now they're so conveniently quiet. Can you explain, like, how much more Obama is using drones and how much more vicious, as you were alluding to before, Obama's attack in Central Asia has been compared to Bush?
Well, the use of the drones by the Obama administration is very important. Now, before I even get into that, let me back up for a second. One point that I make, and I don't know if other people are making it, I'm not hearing people making it, is this debate about the drones. Have you noticed that it's okay to be a liberal in America and criticize Obama on the drones? All of a sudden, you can criticize him, but what happens next? You then make a rationalization as to why you should still vote for Obama. So the drone question has become this kind of this hot topic issue that people are allowed to debate. What we're not allowed to debate are things like imperialism, things like the empire, things like, I mean, all the stuff that you and I are talking about. So that's the one part that I wanted to say. But the way that the drones are used is very important. What the Obama administration has done is not merely expand the drone program. It has, A, delegated it to the CIA, which does not operate under any real rules or norms or anything like that. And B, it has expanded it, I forget what the exact number is, something like 1,000%. So the Obama administration has been drone bombing Pakistan 1,000% more than the Bush administration did. Now, that's not all, though. Let's remember, the Bush administration, which, let me just say, this is one of the most vile things I could imagine, was my memories of the Bush administration, so I'm not suggesting that they're anything other than evil as well, but the Bush administration was not drone bombing Yemen. It was not stationing drones in Djibouti at Camp Lemoneer. It was not attacking 7 to 10 to 15 countries with drones. So what Obama has been able to do that Bush was not is to redefine warfare. It is to redefine what full spectrum dominance means, and in 2012, under Obama, full spectrum dominance means we can bomb you anywhere, anytime, for whatever reason we want, and I get to say who dies.
Thank you. And shifting the folks, the focus a little bit closer towards the Middle East, the so-called Middle East, looking at Syria, the narrative that's coming out of, you know, the liberal media, I mean, Fox News is what it is, but I'd like to remind folks, because a lot of so-called liberals are under the illusion that MSNBC and CNN are you know, somehow putting out this like progressive bastion of news. But the narrative, the corporate media narrative in the U.S., as you know, regarding Syria, is that Bashar al-Assad is this evil dictator, and he's killing, you know, this mass of civilians in places like Homs and Hula, and these rebels, they're freedom fighters, Eric. They're freedom fighters. Can you tell us what's really going on in Syria and who these so-called freedom fighters are, the rebels are, and who's aiding them?
Wow. Okay, that's a big one.
Yeah.
All right. So Syria, the situation in Syria is the following. I mean, this begins in March of 2011, and it really actually began with some very substantive and very real protests, demands about heating oil and subsidies and, you know, these economic things that what happened, though, was that really right at the outset, you had these unknown militants who knows where they came from, who were already armed, and they were instigating rioting. They were involved in sniper shootings and in generally creating chaos. So that was the genesis of what's happened in Syria. But to pull back from that a little bit, the broad perspective is that Syria is a perfect example of what I would call the newer phase of imperialism. See, the British, they could just invade you. They could just send their military, they could invade you, occupy, administer, and control for in perpetuity. The United States can't really do that. So instead, what the United States does is, to achieve strategic aims, it attempts to destabilize countries, to foment civil wars. Every country is different and every situation is different. In Syria, what we're now seeing is all of these sectarian divides that really have been completely erased in Syria under Assad, under the secular rule of Assad. These are now becoming much more apparent, and the so-called freedom fighters, as you mentioned, or terrorists, as I would call them, have now streamed into the country and are trying to instigate sectarian war. Now, that should sound familiar to those of us who were involved in the anti-Iraq war protesting, because that's exactly what happened in Iraq. Now, the strategic goal of this for the United States would be to divide and to break up Syria. Syria is part of an arc of Shiite dominance, and this is an arc that stretches from Tehran to Baghdad, where Prime Minister Maliki represents the Shia majority there, to Damascus with Assad, and to Lebanon with Hezbollah. And so what you see then is that the United States is attempting to break that arc of dominance by destroying Syria, and this is merely a prelude to a war with Iran. That is the ultimate objective, at least in the medium term. Who are they? They're international terrorists, many of them. A lot of them are actually veterans of the war in Libya, the fight against Gaddafi, and they are, I don't want to necessarily say directly on the payroll of U.S. intelligence, but they're operatives. I mean, they work with and for U.S. intelligence. And so what they did in Libya was destabilize the country, destroy Gaddafi, and destroy the country. What are they doing in Syria? Well, they're imported from Libya into Syria to do exactly the same thing. They're coming from Libya, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, but also places as far-flung as Pakistan, Afghanistan, Kosovo, and, you know, many, many other places. So this is really an international destabilization campaign spearheaded by the imperial powers of Europe and the United States to destroy Syria.
Thank you, Eric. And I really like that connection that you made between Libya, Syria, and Iraq in those similar situations. And I'd like to ask you, since the corporate media has very much taken its eye away from what's going on in Libya after the U.S. assassinated Gaddafi and through CIA-sponsored forces, what are people in Bani Walid, for example, going through right now? What's the situation on the ground in Libya currently?
Well, it's tough. I mean, it's almost painful to even really describe it if you have any concept of what Libya was before this aggression. But what is the situation now? Well, in Bani Walid, the story that is not being told, or is very minimally told, is that this was a part of the resistance. This was the Green Resistance continuing the fight against the what they believe to be, and I would agree with them, the illegitimate government that is a puppet of the West. So in Bani Walid, we saw a siege. We have reports that, I mean, we know the siege lasted for weeks, but we have many reports that I believe to be very accurate that show chemical weapons being used against the people of Bani Walid. In other words, the continuation of atrocities that we saw throughout Libya during the war, One thing that is never mentioned or very rarely mentioned is the ethnic cleansing of the Fezzan province in particular and of black Libyans more generally, the destruction of the Tawerga tribe, the destruction of many of these sectarian groups and these tribal groups. And so Bani Walid, I think, is just another example of the continuation of this war. What is the situation on the ground? Well, I mean, we have many competing militias who refuse to disarm, who do not really answer to anybody other than their own leadership. So you have a so-called government in Tripoli with its other face in Benghazi, but they really control very, very little. The control is regional, it is tribal, it is clan-based, it is ethnic, and it is incredibly dangerous. And all of the gains that were made under Gaddafi, things like education, healthcare, agriculture, water projects, all of these are distant memories for the people.
Thank you. One of the things I love about your podcast is not just first and foremost, it's a wealth of information, and it's all like well-resourced and referenced, where folks can click on links and they'll take them exactly to the articles in which you talk about within your podcast. But also the fact that, you know, you do put your perspectives out there, and you know, one of your recent podcasts, you put it out there that you shed tears for the people who have lost their lives by way of drones. You shed tears for the people in Libya, in places like Bani Walid, and you were speaking about the fact that you don't shed any tears about, former U.S. ambassador to Libya, Christopher Stevens. A lot of folks don't know the narrative. They might not, if they're used to or they're obsequious to the U.S. corporate media, they're like, oh, why the hell would he say that? And they don't know to the level that Christopher Stevens was directly involved and complicit in the suffering of tens of thousands of people, in different places in Libya. Can you tell us a little bit more about Christopher Stevens and why you said that?
Sure. And before I even do that, let me just say that I'm not minimizing that his family has gone through suffering because of this. I mean, that's just human nature.
Right.
But absolutely. I mean, Chris Stevens, this is Let's examine first how did he become ambassador? He wasn't the ambassador to Libya under Gaddafi. This was the envoy of the United States intelligence establishment to the rebels that we came to call the NTC, the National Transitional Council, which was composed of some anti-Gaddafi Libyans, but also foreigners and other extremists, and in particular, Chris Stevens was an envoy to the Libyan Islamic Fighting Group, the LIFG, which was led by a guy named Belhaj. And Belhaj became the military commander of Tripoli. This is a U.S. intelligence asset who trained in Afghanistan, who has bragged about, going all over the world, killing Americans and being involved in terrorism. He was extradited through the rendition program to Libya, and he was rotting in a Libyan prison until, under pressure, Gaddafi released him. Now, I'm going in a different direction, but the bottom line is that the situation in Libya with these militias, these have emerged out of these various terrorist organizations which were brought in by the United States. But coming back to the question, we can't just say, oh, well, it was the United States, it was the CIA. No, there are very specific people who have very specific functions, and Chris Stevens was one of those people. Ask yourself, why was this so-called ambassador to Libya in Benghazi and not in Tripoli, the actual capital of the country? Well, because Benghazi is the seat of the rebellion, Benghazi is the hotbed of terrorism and extremism, and Benghazi is where he was coordinating and recruiting terrorists to send to Syria. That's right, Syria. So Chris Stevens was involved in not just the destruction of Libya, but in fomenting a civil war in Syria, and it's for that reason and many others that I shed no tears for him.
Thank you, Eric. I want to kind of shift gears a little bit and look at what's going on in Iran right now. During the presidential debates, we've heard much talk on Iran, and that, both presidential candidates said they would do anything to stop Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons, which you and I both know there's no proof of at this point. But how close do you think the U.S. is right now to an all-out physical war with Iran?
Tough to say. I try to shy away from speculating on things like that as much as I can, simply because it is merely speculation, because we never know. The reality is that the United States has been at war with Iran for a long time and continues to be at war with Iran. It's merely a covert war. When you engage in a program of assassinations, of subversions, of sabotage, espionage, not to mention economic warfare in the form of these sanctions and countless other ways that they're doing it, there is already a war going on. But coming back to your question, the question of a hot war is tough, because a Romney administration, I think we were much closer to a war with Iran, simply because they're lunatics. These are lunatic neocons who wanted to redeem themselves by showing that they're not weaklings. I don't know, they're crazies. But when it comes to Obama is a little bit, I think, less receptive to the idea of a war with Iran. And I think, and I'm saying this partially because I hope this is true, that we're a little bit further away from a war with Iran than we were, say, a year ago. I think that Obama is now in legacy mode. Obama is trying to figure out a way to not make himself look like the greatest, traitor to progressive liberalism or anything like that. He's trying to figure out a way to save face. So I'm not so sure that Obama wants a war with Iran. Now, that being said, I don't think Obama makes these decisions. I don't think that Obama really has a say in all of this. So in answer to the question, we could be quite close to a war with Iran, and it's very important that everybody mobilize in the peace movement and in all of the movements across this country to say no to any war with Iran. I recently interviewed the president of the American-Iranian Friendship Committee, and we were talking about this exact same issue, and it's impossible to say, because imperialism, by its very definition, is unpredictable in that way. This ruling class based in Wall Street and in London and elsewhere, they need to feed on the weak around the world. They need this to sustain themselves, otherwise they will collapse. So how close are we to a war with Iran? We might be close, we might not be. It's tough to say.
Thank you, Eric. And what we do know is, in terms of Obama, what he has said publicly about Iran is that he often loves to beat his chest and talk about the sanctions that the U.S. and its so-called selective international community has put onto Iran, and how it's strangling, and it's putting pressure on Ahmadinejad and his cabinet in Iran. So most Americans have this illusion that, you and I know that first and foremost, that sanctions destroy. Sometimes we get caught up in this G.I. Joe mode and think that the only way people are killed in these wars is by gun or by bomb. But sanctions, as we know, look at Iraq. I mean, how many hundreds of thousands of people, were lost their lives because of these brutal sanctions that were strapped on Iraq. Can you tell our viewers what these sanctions actually do, in terms of how do they hurt the regular, ordinary, quote unquote ordinary people in Iran?
Sure, and I think that that's a really important question too, that is often overlooked, as you mentioned. Well, the sanctions, at least from the Obama administration's public acknowledgement of them, the sanctions are designed to hurt the government. These are not targeting the people, remember. These don't affect the people. It's only at the central bank and the government, and so how could this possibly be bad? Well, the reality is, and I covered this on my show, that there is a lack of medicine, basic medicines. There is a lack of staple foods. They're unable to import many important goods, commodities, items because of the sanctions on the central bank. So, I mean, it's almost self-evident to me how it affects people, that they can't get the things they need to live. I mean, food, water, shelter, medicine. I mean, these are the most basic things that we could possibly imagine. These become much more difficult under a sanctions regime. And you brought up Iraq, and I think that that's an important precedent. Remember that we had, estimates say around 1 million people who died because of those sanctions. And remember, Madeleine Albright said, oh, it was worth it, that this was worth it. The sanctions were worth it. So they affect the people on the ground in that way, but it's also the destabilization of the currency. The currency devaluing, the inflation that has happened because of the sanctions means people simply cannot actually buy the things that even are there. And more importantly even, many Iranians know people who are working abroad who can no longer send money home because of the sanctions on the central bank and the various other international financial transaction systems. So that's just a number of ways in which they affect the people. But I would also remind listeners and viewers that sanctions are not supposed to work. That's the whole idea. It's a sham. I mean, this is like, you know, this is like buying counterfeit stuff on Canal Street in New York City. You know, you can't possibly pass it off as what you're saying it is. You know, sanctions are a prelude to war. They're designed to create discord between the population and itself and the population and its government, and to try to instigate a war scenario. So sanctions are just a prelude to war, just like a no-fly zone is a prelude to war. You think a no-fly zone is actually to prevent airplanes from getting into the air? No, it's to instigate a situation that could then lead to a war. That's what we saw in Libya. I think that's the best example. Remember, the UN resolution in Libya was for a no-fly zone, not for a war. But it became a war within, I mean, hours, essentially. So the sanctions, along with things like a no-fly zone, this is prelude to war. And coming back to the question about whether or not we're going to go to war with Iran, if these sanctions are expanded and we start to see talk of no-fly zone or humanitarian buffers or whatever, well, then we are very close to a war.
Thank you, Eric. I'd like to ask you if you could explain to our viewers who MEK is, what terrorist acts they've committed in Iran, and what it means when we hear that they've been taken off the U.S.'s selective terrorist list.
Sure. Very important. The MEK, also known as the MKO, is a terrorist organization called the Mujahideen-e-Khalq. And this is a group that ostensibly emerged out of a Marxist opposition movement in Iran in the 1960s, who were resisting the Shah, or, I mean, at least at the time, that was the situation. But they were pushed out of Iran by 1979, by the Islamic Revolution there, and they were then housed in Iraq on the other side of the border. What happened then was that the MEK became a part of the U.S.-instigated war between Iraq and Iran. They were, I mean, what could we call them? A paramilitary force that was implemented for the purpose of assassinations, targeted terrorist attacks, and things like this. And it's because of that and many other reasons that the MEK was listed by the State Department as a U.S.-recognized terrorist organization. And this was true up until a few weeks ago when, after much lobbying, and I will remind people, by Republicans and Democrats, okay, lobbying by Republicans and Democrats to take them off of that terrorist list. But I think even the more pertinent question is why? Because they are the force that will be used to destabilize Iran. And you cannot provide material support to a listed terrorist organization. They have to be delisted before you can publicly support them. So, again, I mean, it's part of the assault on Iran, and this flies in the face of international law, international justice, and this is, I think, a critical issue. Terrorism is the favorite tool of imperialists. It's the favorite weapon in their arsenal because it basically gives them all of the benefits of a war minus the war. Okay, so when we're talking about terrorism around the world, I know it's cliche, but it's true. The United States is the greatest sponsor of terrorism in the world, and I don't mean that in an abstract or philosophical or metaphysical sense. I mean that in a very practical and very physical sense of the word.
Right. We're told, thank you, Eric. We're told that Assad is a dictator. We're told that he was committing mass atrocities and he was brutalizing people. But in Bahrain, that actually has been happening. That's been happening for some time. What is the relationship between the U.S. and Bahrain, and why is Bahrain, why are they kept off of the national dialogue here and the U.S. corporate media, you know, for the crimes that they commit against their civilians?
The answer to both questions is the same, because it's a client state of Saudi Arabia, which is in turn a client state of the United States, because Bahrain houses the U.S. Navy Fifth Fleet, because it is the military foothold in the Persian Gulf that the United States enjoys, for all of those reasons. And then let's take even the broader perspective on this. It's very critical because Bahrain is a, well, for one thing, it is a minority-ruled country. The Al Khalifa ruling family is the minority ethnic group there. Their relations with Saudi Arabia is critical. And these are all feudal monarchies. These are monarchies. And they understand that in the wake of the Arab Spring in 2012, monarchy is on its way out. And and I'm not suggesting that the Arab Spring was what the mainstream media claims it was, some kind of, naturally occurring, organic, democratic movement. But every country was different. And what you see in Kuwait, just like what you see in Bahrain right now, is a real revolutionary movement. It's important to remember that real revolutions are things like overthrowing a monarchy. That's a real revolution. It's not sitting in a square talking about corruption. That's not revolution. Now, I'm not disparaging what happened in Egypt, but I don't consider that to be a real revolution. What's happening in Bahrain is a revolutionary situation. You have leaders of this movement who are sitting in prison on hunger strike, and they were put in prison merely for a tweet, for tweeting that people should stand up against an authoritarian government. It was a very minor, moderate tweet, I have to say. It wasn't anything radical. It certainly wasn't as vicious as I might have said. But, I think that Bahrain serves this geopolitical interest, and the GCC more generally, that's the Gulf Cooperation Council, which includes all of those Gulf monarchies. That would be Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, and so forth. All of these countries are part of the U.S. sphere of influence, and they're used as a weapon against, and this is the critical issue, and I love the fact that you have that picture behind you, because it's also relevant, because this is the attack on secular nationalism. It is the attack on what used to be called pan-Arabism, Arab nationalism. So undoing the legacy of that and perpetuating these monarchies, that is what the United States is interested in. Bahrain is on the front lines of all of that. Why does it not make the headlines? Well, because it would be incredibly dangerous if it did, because then people would ask the question, why does the United States support the Syria rebels and not the ones in Bahrain? You can't have people asking dangerous questions like that, because the answers would also be equally dangerous.
That's right.
Thank you, Eric. USAID has a track record that is very questionable in many aspects. We know that CIA agents have been using the agency to, under disguise, destabilize countries. And right now we know that Russia recently ordered USAID to leave the country. Could you tell us why that is?
Sure, and people should also know that it wasn't just Russia. Bolivia's done it, Venezuela's done it, many countries are doing it, and they're watching the other countries to see who does it and how it works. Why are they doing this? Because USAID is part of a very complex network of intelligence, what can we call them, organizations, intelligence organs, which are all connected to the U.S. Imperial system. And this includes USAID, the National Endowment for Democracy, Freedom House, the International Republican Institute. I mean, I could go on and on and on. I mean, there's dozens of them. So what do? They bring in, the most important thing they do is they bring in the money. The money to fund manufactured opposition in countries all over the world. And I'm not just talking about the well-documented concept of the color revolution. The color revolution is a concept in and of itself that we saw in Georgia, Ukraine, and so forth. But there's more to it. It's not just the color revolutions. It's also about destabilizing the actual government there and creating a system where the United States can exert dominance without actually exerting any dominance. So you can do things like pick and choose who the opposition is. And the way that USAID does that is simply by doing things like holding organizational workshops, putting people in touch with other people, organizing in an indirect way, and then, of course, bringing in the money. Russia was a perfect example of all of this. The so-called protest movement in Russia against Putin was entirely manufactured, and it was manufactured primarily by the National Endowment for Democracy and U.S. Ambassador Michael McFaul in Russia, in Moscow. So what USAID and National Endowment for Democracy, what they're able to do is subvert countries without the United States even pretending that they're involved in it.
Thank you. Eric, our last question for you, and I want to thank you first and foremost for giving up your valuable time today to join us and to bequeath, you know, our listeners and our viewers with information, and I really implore our listeners and viewers to please make sure that you go to stopimperialism.com right now, Google it, or just go directly to the website. And trust me, all you got to do is click on it, do as I do. You can walk around, do some stuff around your room, your house, and just listen to the podcast. It's really powerful. So I thank you for your time, and most importantly, I thank you for your work. The last question I wanted to ask you is, we you know, folks that reside within America have heard the term austerity, and most of all linked up with countries like Portugal, Spain, you know, Greece, and so forth, and some others. You recently helped organize a conference in New York City around austerity, and I just want to ask you, why did you feel organizing a conference around austerity was so important, especially within the U.S., where maybe a lot of Americans think that they're very far distance from austerity or austerity ever coming to American shores?
Well, a number of reasons why I did it. I think the most important is because what we are facing, and we're seeing it right now. When I was initially conceptualizing this and working with others to organize it, I kind of thought of the whole thing as being like this way to organize people to say, we oppose Romney and Obama, both of whom are going to cut your throats after this election. So, I mean, it was partially for that political reason, to try to get people into the same room working together in opposition to that. But the austerity question is so misrepresented and just not understood in this country. We don't use the word austerity here. See, that's the key. We're all about propaganda in the United States, and it's all about phrasing and you know, diction and so forth. We call it things like fiscal responsibility or belt tightening, or if you've turned on the TV at all in the last couple of months, fiscal cliff. The fiscal cliff is what everyone is concerned about, this dangerous thing that no one really understands why it's so dangerous, because it's not, because it's totally manufactured. But to organize against austerity means to fight for economic rights. That's how I think of it. It's not that, you know, I've been involved with many organizations and movements which have said, we oppose blank, we oppose this, we oppose that. But what are you for? What are you actually for? And to me, any anti-austerity movement is for economic rights. It is not, you know, healthcare and housing and education. These are not the gifts bestowed upon us by a benevolent ruling class. These are our rights. These are our inheritance from the generations that came before us. And that is what is under attack. Austerity means, well, two things happening simultaneously. Massive cuts to every social program, every aspect of the social safety net, and simultaneous privatization of every public institution that could possibly be privatized. So that is what austerity is, and that is what we are facing. Obama, look, I mean, the treachery of Obama knows no bounds, because he is able to stand in front of the American public and say, I am going to reach across the aisle to work with everybody, and everyone stands up and applauds like he's, you know, he's such a great leader for doing this. Yeah. Well, what if I reached across the aisle to work with Mephistopheles? Does that make me a good, you know, politician? I mean, you know, the idea of reaching across the aisle, this grand bargain, as they call it, the grand bargain is when the 1% gets together and says, hey, you want to destroy the 99% as quickly as we possibly can? And they all say, yeah. And then there's your austerity. Now, there's advanced cases of this. Greece is a good example. What's happened in Greece? All of the public institutions are now in the process of being privatized, or many of them are. The Acropolis, I believe, was sold, or is possibly going to be sold to a private institution. I don't even know where. But the idea is that you have to pay. The working class, the working people have to pay for the malfeasance of the rich. That is the idea of austerity. It is shifting the burden from those who created the depression to those who have to pay for it. That's essentially what austerity is, and we've seen it all throughout Europe, and it's brought down many governments. And so how do you do that here in the United States? Well, you have to mobilize, you have to organize, you have to create coalitions, you have to do all of the groundwork that real revolutionaries do. I'm sick and tired of people calling themselves revolutionaries while they sit in a coffee shop and do nothing.
That's right.
Coffee shop revolutions are for wimps.
That's right. Thank you so much. I couldn't agree more. Thank you so much for your time and for coming on Your World News. And, you know, we look forward to working with you in the future.
Thanks so much for having me.
No problem. For Tim Bodoff-Lenchen, I'm Solomon Kamajan. That's Eric Draitser. Please go to stopimperialism.com. And this has been Critical Insights on Your World News. Take care.